Good evening. We're coming to you live from the Tshwane Event Center, or as we call it, the ROC, the Results Operations Center here in Tshwane. My name is Adriaan Basson, Editor-in-Chief of News24, and welcome to our evening episode of Ballot Box, where we bring you all the live action from the Election Center in Tshwane. I'm joined tonight on set by Quinita Hunter, as always, our political editor, and Dawie Scholtz, News24's elections analyst. But he also dabbles in politics from time to time. Dawie hasn't slept a lot, so please forgive him if he speaks a bit slower than yesterday. But he and Quinita will guide us through the day's big events, because there's been a lot. And if you have followed News24 on your phone or on your laptop today, you would have seen those push notifications coming through one after the other. And probably the biggest one today, Quinita, I know this is a municipal election, and yes. I mean, we are going to talk a lot about municipalities tonight. But probably the biggest and most significant, and in the words of Professor Tinjiku Maluleke, the Rubicon moment was that the ANC projection is now to dip below 50%, or that the ANC nationally together will go below 50, down towards 47%.
Yes, and that's what is probably the big picture here. And it's, when you break that number down, you see what we're seeing on the board now, where the ANC is leading in municipalities, but not controlling those municipalities, because its majority has been chipped away in so many municipalities across the country. It's KwaZulu-Natal, even in stronghold areas like Mpumelelo, you see that majority. So when you tell me that this is what the projection says, I can see this already in the early councils that have been called. About more than 50 or so have been called. 32 are hung, which paints a very, very, very drastic picture. Just to put it into context, AB, the last time around, the ANC, the hung municipalities were just 27 after 100% of the votes were counted. We're now sitting at not even 50% of the votes counted. Yes, the IEC is saying that by tonight there'll be 90% done, but there's a very interesting picture here, where the ANC's majority, even in its stronghold areas, are diminished. If you look at areas in Mpumelelo, I'll just use that as an example, where the ANC actually doesn't really have much of an opposition there. And you see it go from 68 to 54. You see it go from 67 to 52. That, for me, is a very, very telling picture. More than what you guys are going to talk about in terms of the city of Joburg. Those are kind of, as a political reporter, those are kind of expected outcomes.
Yes.
But for me, the interesting bits is where the ANC goes from the majority party, not to the second party as official opposition, but going in some municipality as the third party, which for me is very telling.
Dawie, in 2016, there was already the tectonic plates started to shift already with the metros, right? We saw the ANC going under 50 in Johannesburg, Nelson Mandela Bay, and Tshwane, right? And losing control initially over those metros. They regained some of them. But this is big. This is national. Tell us, just how did you get to this 47.2%, I think, and why does it matter?
Yeah. It's really interesting that you mentioned 2016, because it's almost as if everything that happened in 2016 just went further and was more amplified in this election. So in 2016, the ANC had a big problem with its voters not voting. Lots of talk about people punishing the ANC by not voting, and lots of the opposition voters going to vote. That was, the effect of that was even much worse in this election. So a lot of ANC supporters didn't go to vote in this election. So low ANC turnout, high opposition turnout, that's one of the kind of key reasons we got to that. But the model that we've built looks into the demographics of the country and the voting patterns within different demographic groups to try to distill what the result will be at the end of the day. And there's a couple of just really interesting core demographic drivers. Can I go into them?
Yeah, sure.
That kind of drive this result, right? And as I said, they're a bit connected to those 2016, kind of patterns we saw. So the one is just, the ANC has historically relied on really large majorities in the black electorate to kind of win elections and win them quite easily, right? And I think there's two important trends in this election. The one is with black voters in KZN, I think we saw a really big shift in this election. And in 2016, the ANC won 67% of those voters. If I look at the voting districts that are already in, which is quite a significant portion of KZN, and do a demographic analysis of those, they're down from 67 to 54 in that portion of the electorate.
Sure.
And it's gone significantly to the IFP, so a lot of IFP votes in northern KZN, but also really big EFF inroads in the more urban part of KZN. Okay. And that's driving, I think, kind of one of the big national shifts. Is that
so a big move from black voters in KZN away from the ANC.
Exactly. And you see the same thing nationally, but the numbers are a little bit different. The national black electorate outside of KZN is about 74% voting for the ANC in 2016. It's down to 68% in 2021. So there's this sort of almost kind of relatively evenly shaped movement away from the ANC. And I will make one minor kind of comment on that, except for the Eastern Cape. The Eastern Cape and sort of portions of the Western Cape, real strength of the ANC there. That's really, really interesting, and we'll maybe talk about that later.
The Eastern Cape is coming through for the ANC. Juanita, are you surprised by that?
Absolutely not. I think it's very, very clear what the Eastern Cape was. And I mean, they benefited from low voter turnout, right? So that's where it's quite interesting. I'm very fascinated by the Western Cape and how the DA is losing its stronghold there. Let's talk about Beaufort West, right? Yes, it was a coalition, but the DA further dropped in Beaufort West. Oudtshoorn, same thing. The DA was there, and now it's a hung municipality. What shocked me was Cape Agulhas. We at News24 ran the out of order index, and we said that Cape Agulhas is the best run municipality in South Africa, governed by the DA. The one seat that they had that gave them the majority went to the DA, to the ANC.
To the ANC.
And so what you're seeing then is a slip. And a lot of this hung municipalities, yes, it is punishing to the ANC that was given, but you see interesting situations in the Western Cape. For me, and then you also see smaller political parties, local, your civic movements in areas like Canaland, etc., where people, smaller political parties played a clawed into the DA's
I think there was
support
in the Cedarburg Farmers Movement Party.
Tea
Farmers.
Well, what is it? Cedarburg? Yes.
Yeah, the Cedarburg Tea Farmers Association.
Yes.
No, there was one. Yester, is that how you pronounce it?
First Movement. Yeah. The First Movement.
Yester. So they were that's a very good example, because the Democratic Alliance was the majority party. They've now moved to third place in one election. That for me is very shocking. The other point I want to make on this, AB, is that in Mpumalanga, where the ANC performance has been dismal in terms of service delivery, terrible, pathetic. I can't tell you how bad it is, right?
Atrocious.
Let's take the Lekwa municipality. Yes. A JSE-listed company had to go to court to force service delivery in that municipality, right? So it is inevitable that the ANC support would drop. Inevitable. It was going to happen. From 60-something percent down to the early 50s, still have a majority. So that, for me, was not shocking. Then I look at the DA numbers. The DA drops in a municipality like that. So what happens to the DA's message that says the DA governs better? That, for me, is an interesting trend. The other thing is, and maybe we'll talk about this tomorrow when we get a broader picture, Patriotic Alliance making its way as third place in a lot of, just one seat here and there. I find that very fascinating, because they come from a zero base.
Yes.
And they're outperforming parties like the EFF.
Before we go to the smaller parties, I do want to just end on the ANC and this historic moment projection that we made today, or that Dawie made, that we endorsed, obviously, is that the ANC will go under 50% nationally, the national support. That is a major moment.
Yes.
It doesn't bode well for Cyril Ramaphosa and his party on the way to 2024.
Yeah.
Do you think they can pull themselves back from this moment, or is this, like we saw with 2016 to here, a slide that's just going to continue?
Yeah, I think that they are not shocked by our forecast. They did not oppose it in any way. They're not, blindly optimistic. They're very realistic. They said no voter turnout, and we have to listen to what people said. The hard thing for them now is, how are you going to convince people to vote for you in the next national elections, because now you're going to lose big metros like Johannesburg, etc. Now the ANC is going to think long and hard in terms of coalitions.
Yes.
They no longer have the bargaining power they used to have.
Yes.
And so definitely an indication of what's to come. More importantly, the desperate use of Ramaphosa, did it pay off? They say it did. It's going, it's a lot. They say it could have been far worse.
Well, I don't know what far worse would have looked like, because it looks pretty damning if you look at the metros. Dawie, quickly just recap for us, and we're not going to spend a lot of time on them because we have spoken about them earlier today, but just maybe the result or the projection in Cape Town. Let's start there, Cape Town.
So Cape Town this morning, we projected first thing for the DA to maintain.
Yes.
I think this morning we said 58% for the DA, 19% for the ANC, and obviously all the others as well. I'm happy to report that after a full day of more results coming in, the model now says it's going to be 59 for the DA and 18 for the ANC. So kind of tracking for roughly what we projected.
But the DA still, the magical 60 still eludes them from two-thirds in 2016.
Absolutely. Still a very big drop for the DA in the Cape
Town. But the DA wins Cape Town. They're going to win Cape Town. Jordan Hill-Lewis will be the mayor of Cape Town.
Yeah.
The ANC is all but dying in Cape Town.
Yeah.
Now below 20% on 18 you project. Can we move to Ekurhuleni? Now there we have a very interesting scenario.
Yes, that one was really interesting. So I think there we projected the ANC on 38 that morning, the DA on 29, the EFF on 14, the Action SA on 6, and EFF on Freedom Front Plus on 4. And that projection is held. So I think we've now gotten a lot more numbers in, and it's still at that level.
The ANC has dropped. They dropped from in the 40s, in the 40, high 40s.
So they were 48, I think it's minus 10.
It's minus 10. But Kwanita, the ANC, Mzwandile Masina, of course not the biggest fan of President Ramaphosa, is likely to remain in that coalition with the EFF, which will get them over the 50 line to 52.
We don't know for sure if he'll be the mayoral candidate, right? So that's just one. But you know, in politics, anything is possible.
Yes.
Definitely, there will be some sort of coalition with the ANC. Will try to force its way in Ekurhuleni. I don't think Ekurhuleni is one that they will be able to concede, you know, and they would do everything in their power to get Ekurhuleni and to take over there. I think what's important is that it was very evident that despite their efforts to say we got clean audit, you know, the Auditor General has given us a clean audit, it was not enough because service delivery stinks in the area. And so that was really a performance appraisal of Mzwandile Masina.
But the ANC has probably done just enough to hang on to the mayorship. They're on 38, the second biggest party is the DA on 29, who will then have to probably make a deal with the EFF, which is very unlikely. Mashaba's Action SA didn't do that well in Ekurhuleni. So I think at this stage, it's likely that the ANC-EFF relationships will continue. But as you say, everything is back on the table. Mankgoong, what did we see happening in the, as Peter de Tour, our colleague, wrote, the city formerly known as the City of Roses?
So I think Mankgoong is a very interesting one. You know, the ANC has traditionally won there very easily. You know, if you looked at the 2019 result, it sort of implied 57, 58 for them. It came out 51. So, like, a big drop, right? I think ANC 51, DA 25, EFF 10, Freedom Front Plus 4, which is what we projected and still holding at that level. So ANC still governing there, but I think now on thin ice in Mongolia.
So that's one. That's going to be one of the very few metros that the ANC goes over 50, right?
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Despite all the terrible things we've read and seen in Mankgoong in terms of service delivery, Kwanita, no opposition party were able to push them over.
Yeah, but
the
I think regardless, this is still a very telling result because I mean they were arrogant, the ANC in that particular metro. I'm interested in Itekwini. We're not getting, is it slow figures, Doug?
Very slow. So we have an internal projection within the team.
Which we won't announce.
Yes,
yet, no.
Exactly.
Please, I beg.
it's still taking shape because there's very slow counting.
We have two big announcements coming, so just hold on, Kwanita. And then last quick recap, Nelson Mandela Bay. Very much similar picture than 5 years ago.
Yes, and that one is going to be a real mess from a coalition discussion perspective. So DA on 42, this is our final result. DA 42 projected. We projected the ANC on 40. It looks like they're going to actually go towards 39. EFF on 6. And then Good on 1. UDM on 1. Freedom Front Plus on 1. ACDP on 2 now. PA on 1. And shout out to my friends in Trebecha. The AIM, who are also on 1, and we'll have some seats. So, yes.
So the DA will literally have to get each of those small ones to hopefully get to 50%.
That's a shopping basket.
It's going to be a very challenging situation.
Or go into a coalition with the ANC,
yes.
Which is something we'll talk about. Okay, thank you for those recaps. So there you have it. In Cape Town, the DA is going to hold Cape Town. In Ekurhuleni, no party over 50, but the ANC on 38, the largest party. Mankgoong, the ANC magically clinged onto Mankgoong with 51%, and in Nelson Mandela Bay, Nobody got to 50. The DA on 42, ANC on 40 or 39. Now, let's go to our first big announcement of the evening, which is Tshwane. Dawie, can you reveal our projections for Tshwane?
Sure. So the Tshwane result is really a fascinating one. So basically, the DA and the ANC is tied.
Unbelievable.
The ANC is currently projected for 33.7% in Tshwane. The DA is projected for 33.5%. So basically, between 33 and 34 for each of them. Let's just pause on that for a moment. That's quite remarkable because, you know, if that is going to happen, then it would imply that the ANC has gone down by seven points roughly.
Yes.
And the DA
from 41.2.
And the DA has gone down by 9 points roughly. And I'll explain in a moment how that happened. So then the kind of third biggest party is then the EFF at 11. Right, so I think people are starting to do math in their heads,
yes,
right?
Yes.
And then thereafter is the Freedom Front Plus, actually on 8, which is an enormous showing, and I'll explain that as well in a moment, on 8%, and Action SA also on 8%. So that's going to be just a super interesting and complex negotiation discussion. I think the one avenue one potentially sees is the DA is 34, plus the Action SA is 8, right? That's 42, plus the Freedom Front Plus is 8, that's 50. So that if those three parties are willing to get around the table, that's one way to get there.
And we had Herman Mashaba in this exact seat earlier today saying that he will go into a coalition with the DA. He's open to that discussion if they're willing to talk social justice. That was his precondition.
That's going to be an awkward conversation, but I wish them the best of it.
But that is a possibility, I think, yes. What you've put together. Quinita, but let's just pause again. I think, you know, there's such big news, and we must just sometimes just... I mean, the ANC, the Liberation Party, the capital city, 34%. That is a horrendous result for the ANC in Tshwane.
Yeah, but I think it was coming because that's what happens, when you lose in 2016.
And yeah, but you were still on 42, almost 42.
Slippery slope, baby. It goes, and I mean, one can't even rule out it going that foot down even further in the next elections. And I think what was worse is that in Tshwane, there was the ANC, they didn't learn their lesson from 2016, the internal shenanigans, the fact that they were killing each other, literally killing each other for positions for the councillor candidate list, the fact that you had, the fact that there were protests, that the Deputy President David Mabuza had to intervene and promise, this is what actually happened. They said, we know you're unhappy with the candidate, vote ANC, we'll have snap by-elections after this elections.
And when they registered, there were two ANCs with two different lists.
Yes, absolutely. It was absolutely horrendous. The internal shenanigans in the ANC in Tshwane spilled over into this election campaign. And you saw a very, very desperate, David Mabuza particularly, but also the president, going to communities and almost begging them to give the ANC a chance. But then the question is, are we going to give the same people who did nothing for us in the last time round? And that's literally what was put to them. And so I think they're not surprised by that. Even by that figure, they're not surprised because they saw it, they felt it when they went to communities.
And then the DA that has governed this city, has led the government through 5 stormy years, but remained in the leader's position, dropping 9 points after the disaster of, or what they call the disaster of the 2019 election under Musi Maimane's leadership, putting John Steenhuisen as a white male and cozied up to the Afrikaans community, which they lost in 2019, but not regaining any of that vote, in fact losing 8% possibly to the Freedom Front. Just hold a second, Dawie. What does the DA think tonight about their strategy in Tshwane?
No, I think they're sitting there biting their fingernails because first of all, you had 3 mayors in a short space of time.
Yes.
There was a lot of internal instability there. There was also a very good example of the DA blaming other parties for their own woes. Also, being at the mercy of the EFF as they were, literally, we had those News24 town hall discussions where the EFF candidate in Tshwane said to Randall Williams, the mayor, we gave you the blue lights you drive, you know? And so that news around their neck was something that was predominant in this last 5 years. And more importantly, I think, is that people have realized that they can, you know, that, that little distinction between ANC and DA, especially in Tshwane, was something that people felt in the suburbs. You know, in areas like Lodium and I forget the neighboring township, where there was no water for days. What was the DA's response? The DA's response was, we're blaming Rand Water. It may have been a legitimate reason, and I'm not taking away from that, but the point is that it is perhaps easier sometimes to shout from opposition benches than to govern in complicated municipalities or metros like the city of Tshwane, and then doing so without an outright majority, so you can't just do whatever you like.
Dawie, you looked at those maps closely. What happened in Tshwane? Where did those, can you say with a certain degree of certainty where those DA voters went?
Absolutely. So they went in two places. The one is, in 2016, the DA won 10% of the black vote in Tshwane. So they got 10% in the townships, they're down to 5. So they've lost half that vote, and that's significant. That's a lot of voters. The other massive piece is, you know, is the Freedom Front Plus winning 8% in Tshwane.
Massive.
You know, in 2019, the Freedom Front Plus inroads into the DA support base was an immense crisis within the party. At that point, it was 6% in Tshwane. So it's now worse than it was in 2019. So I think we all know how hard the party tried to avert this. So there's going to be a discussion about what the way forward is based on that. And so I think that's basically where it is. They've lost some of the Afrikaans vote, and they've lost some of their supporters in the townships in Tshwane. To the Freedom Front Plus, but we must also not forget the entrance of Action SA, right?
Yes.
So Action SA was kind of taking support from everyone, including the DA.
You're projecting them on 8% in
Tshwane. On 8% now.
So that 8% could come from the ANC majority, I guess.
Yeah.
Right? And maybe some from the DA.
Exactly. It comes a little bit from everyone, as we've seen. Kind of everywhere where Action SA was doing relatively well. It's just interesting. Their support is not as lopsided in any particular part of the city. They were kind of getting like, you know, 6 or 7 or 8 or 9 or 10% almost everywhere. And they were kind of taking it from almost everyone.
From everywhere.
Yeah.
Well, Herman Mashoba earlier today, Kunita told me that they are the only non-racial party. They speak to people across color lines. And as we move to Johannesburg, he may be correct if we look at the results. Because, Dawie, you've got some news out of Joburg for us. Joburg last time, if I can remind our viewers, we had the ANC on 45% in 2016 and the DA on 38. What are we looking at today?
So, looking at a different picture. So the ANC is still the biggest party, but I would make one just little comment, is I just reran the model now while we were speaking, and the ANC is now exactly projecting the same amount in Johannesburg as in Tshwane, 33.7%. So 33-34% for the ANC. 34. 28 for the DA, and we've been projecting that all day. Action SA on 17, so 1-7. The EFF on 11, Freedom Front Plus on 2, the IFP on 2, and PA on 1.
Okay, so let's just say that slowly again, because this is big breaking news that we are projecting on News24 Live for you. The ANC in Johannesburg projected to go from 45% to 34%.
Minus 11 now.
That is a drop of 11 percentage points. And the Democratic Alliance from 38% to 28%.
Yeah.
A drop of 10 percentage points. And the new entrant, Action SA, in its first ever election, scoring 17% in Johannesburg. This is unheard of, Kunita.
Absolutely. I think that Herman Mashaba used his track record as the DA mayor to his advantage, attracting voters in townships and in suburbs, Dawie. I think that's what the numbers are showing. And then, and more importantly, you know, getting that message that, you know, he is sort of an outsider from politics. You know, that message is, are you heartful with politics?
Heartful with politics.
Which,
yes,
is which for me at the time sound, you know, you are a politician, you're contesting a political election. But nonetheless, I think that it resonated with voters in Johannesburg. They again are beneficiary of the support in a very concentrated area.
Yeah.
And I would like to think maybe in future discussions, we could talk about how these more concentrated area-based smaller parties are going to be the future of local government. We're seeing it in for example, areas like Cedarburg, what we mentioned. Johannesburg is a prime example. You know, does Action SA need to even be a national party when it can just take the issues of Joburg seriously, you know, fundamentally change the way the council is run, and just focus all of its attention there. Obviously, Herman Mashaba saying that this would then set them on a course for the national elections, the general elections. That's a different discussion. But I do think that they have been the biggest beneficiary of this complete despondency by voters who have tasted the DA and have tasted the EFF in the last 5 years alone.
ANC.
And the ANC.
Yes, yes. Dawie, where did the Action SA get its votes from? Can you give us one or two examples maybe?
Yeah, so firstly, everywhere, okay? Yes. And I can talk about specific voting stations, yeah. Right?
You said to me in Soweto they made quite a dent. And I mean, that's big trouble for the ANC. Soweto has been an ANC stronghold for many, many years.
Yeah, yeah.
And here's a guy making that breakthrough, right?
Exactly. And there were portions of Soweto where, either Action SA was like kind of, finishing second in the voting station and kind of cutting the ANC vote by half, or actually winning voting stations. Places like Protea Glen, voting stations in Orlando West, they were winning, etc. So, they actually were winning some of those voting stations. But then, if you just look at it in aggregate a little bit, across all of the townships in 2016, the ANC won 74. They were down to 56. Yes, they're minus 20 in the townships, right? Action took 16. So they took 16%, which is that's significant. But what's just fascinating is literally the exact same thing happened in the suburbs, right? So in the suburbs, the DA won 86% of the vote in 2016. They're down to 67 roughly, so also minus 20. Action took 16. So that pattern is what happened across Joburg, and I think why we've got this result, and definitely why no one is anywhere close to 50, right? Because
yes.
Everyone had their support base basically, I wouldn't say halved, but significantly damaged by Action SA. And can I just one more thing?
Yes.
What's interesting about this, though, is the almost isolated nature of the EFF vote. The EFF
yes.
vote stayed yeah. relatively consistent.
Yes.
And it just
sort of floated through. I think you told me earlier today, I don't know if this number still hold, but the EFF has actually gone down a bit in Tswane. From 12 to 11 percentage points.
Yes.
And in Joburg, flat on 11. So the EFF yes. has not grown, Kunita, in Tswane and Joburg. This is not good news for Julius Malema and his fighters.
Absolutely. And I mean, they were very optimistic about KwaZulu-Natal. I'm not really seeing that come through. The fact that we saw in a sort of northern municipality called Idume, which is Paul Petersburg, where the NFP were nowhere in 2016, is the leading majority party there, unseating obviously the ANC. But I'm saying that is the dynamic. You're seeing a lot of still IFP presence. I don't think the EFF is going to be the kingmaker it expects to be. Yes, they will be beneficiaries of increased voter support, but I think that they are not possibly going to play the kingmakers, because there's going to be sort of multiple smaller parties having some sort of say, and especially when the ANC and the DA don't have that authority. So they're going to be hunting not only from the EFF, but they're going to go cap in hand to all smaller political parties.
Let's just quickly talk coalitions now in Johannesburg, Kunita, because this is very interesting. So the ANC is on 34. They need 16, let's call it 16.1% to govern Johannesburg. They could get that from Action SA. Okay, Herman Mashaba sat in this chair. We have him on video saying, I will not go into coalition with the ANC. I'll speak to everyone else, but not the ANC.
Do you believe him?
Well, let's take it at face value, okay, and let's just eliminate that possibility
yeah,
for the moment.
Yeah.
Then the ANC can, what's left for the ANC in Johannesburg? The EFF will get them with 11 percentage points to about 45%. Then they need a few small bodies. They need the IFP, they need the PA, they need Freedom Front Plus and the ACDP. Unlikely to happen. Another possibility is for the DA and Herman Mashaba's Action SA to form a partnership. Dawie, where does that get them?
So 28 plus 17 is what, 45?
Yes.
The Freedom Front Plus has another 2, that's 47. The IFP has another 2, that's 49. Then the ACDP is still floating around, maybe a couple of independents, it's possible.
So here's the interesting thing, 45 is a magical number. DA plus Action SA equals 45, ANC plus EFF equals 45.
Yes.
So both those possibilities are going to be on this floor tonight, speaking to the likes of the Freedom Front Plus, the PA, the ACDP, and the IFP on their knees, Gwendita. Is that what you're looking
Absolutely.
Forward to?
I am rushing from here back to that floor. I want to see the interactions. I want to see the flirtation that happens before the formal talk starts, because that's very important. We are, how far are we, can you just, with voter counting, Dawie? 50%?
Yeah, something like that.
So they say the actual, they will really start negotiating at 70%. That's what the ANC is saying. So in the next 2 hours, we're going to see a lot of frantic discussion on the floor here.
Gwendita, all the best to you and our political team to get inside this coalition, those horse trading discussions, because there will be a lot of that. Dawie Scholtz, thank you so much for bringing us your wonderful projections as always. Looking forward to more through the night. Tomorrow morning we will confirm Itikwini, we will confirm Buffalo City. Thank you again for joining us. Keep your eyes on News24 for the rest of the evening. Before we say goodbye for this episode of Ballot Box, I'm handing you over to my colleague Kelly Anderson, who will tell us what happened on social media today. What were some of the magical stories that you missed, and also some of the polls we ran?
Thank you so much, Adriaan. And I don't know about you guys, but my jaw is still on the floor from those Johannesburg results. Incredible stuff. I'm going to get back to talking about Action SA in a moment. But first, I just want to go through a little bit of the reactions from social media today with Dawie's predictions. So Dawie tweeted out the national predictions today, and there was a lot of reaction. And I want to kind of take you through some of it to see what people have been saying. So first tweet we have here: if this holds, it is surely, finally, the end of the road for John Steenhuisen and Helen Zille. Memani got canned for getting 1.4% less of the vote in 2019 than 2014. Currently, Steenhuisen and Zille are bleeding votes, and municipalities are heading for a greater percentage drop. Mpumelelo seems to agree with the sentiment, saying the DA has dropped 5% nationally, surely Steenhuisen is toast. There is a precedent of holding DA leaders accountable for electoral performance. Now on to the ANC. The fall and fall of the ANC continues. Musi Maimane is correct. The electorate is definitely rejecting current political parties. Bring on the 2024 elections. And finally, the decline of South Africa's ruling ANC continues. Without drastic change, the ANC could be forced into a coalition at the next general election, or worse. So yeah, not looking good for the ANC or the DA, but like I said, there is one party that it is looking very good for, and that is Action SA. So today, News24 ran a story titled "Homer Mashaba Gains Ground in Johannesburg as ANC Buckles in Soweto." News24 readers left a lot of comments on this article, and here are some of their sentiments. One reader wrote, "As a white DA voter in the Western Cape, I would love for Action SA to grow into a party with strong representation in all provinces. The ANC is now a corrupt shell of its old self, while the DA is moving inexplicitly to the right." Another reader says, "Delighted for Mr. Mashaba and Action SA. Well done. It's not over yet, so hopefully many more voting districts still to come. The biggest victory here is seeing the ANC support decline, regardless of who takes the votes. Fantastic news on a Tuesday morning." And lastly, "As a DA member, I can't help but think if the DA stayed with Mashaba and Musi Maimane, where the DA would have been today." So lots of support for Mashaba from our readers. So these were the biggest stories of the day, but there were a few stories on News24 that you may have missed amongst all the massive stories that we published today. I want to take you through two of them. First of all, the story of the water heroes and Harry Smith. What started as a volunteer group in Harry Smith aimed at funding and fixing critical service delivery failures and infrastructure in 2018 has turned into a group of independent candidates contesting four wards in the 2021 municipal elections. The Water Heroes took matters into their own hands, rallying the community for assistance and money to fix water supply, electricity problems, and damaged infrastructure. Their hopes were, however, dashed when residents decided to vote for the DA and ANC in these wards instead. The group's leader, political veteran Willie Shabalala, said they would continue to work despite their loss. And lastly, the story of the Cape Coloured Congress, who raked in Cape Town votes in its first election, despite no money for posters. Without money to fund its campaign, its volunteers went door to door to encourage people to vote for them. Mayoral candidate Fadil Adams believed the support they received was from former DA voters. He believes the truth about the realities facing historically disadvantaged neighbourhoods in the city is what made its message resonate with voters. So if you haven't read those two stories today, I highly suggest you go to News24, check them out. Excellent stuff from the elections today. We would love for you to be part of the conversation. If you'd like to become a News24 subscriber and get part of the comments section, you can go to news24.com/subscription. That's all from me. Thank you. Back to you, Adriaan.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Kelly. I must say, Konita, for me, one of the most interesting stories of this election has been these smaller parties. Dawie, have you seen the smaller parties making any interesting? I see Ikosa is on the board there. I mean, that is obviously Beaufort West, right? Where they will have a big say. We've just heard the Cape Coloured Congress doing really well in some wards in Cape Town. I mean, it is interesting and refreshing. Action SA being the ringleader of the new entrants, the NFP, we heard Idumbe. You know, it's interesting to see new kids on the block. It's refreshing.
Yeah, absolutely. I think in an environment where people are annoyed with the status quo, where they're looking for alternatives, they are going to look at community-based alternatives, new parties, smaller parties, think about other ideas. And, you know, I must confess, you know, when we build these projection models, we always think about, you know, the five or six or seven parties you're likely to see a lot of votes for, and you build the model around them. And, you know, I will admit it, we have accidentally excluded one or two or three parties throughout this process, like the Cape Coloured Congress. And there's been a significant amount of sort of other votes that are not projected for, right, that are new parties,
yes,
and much more than usual. So,
and we now know those other 1, 2, 3, 4 seats will make or break
huge
in a coalition, Juanita. Is this the beginning of new politics for South Africa? Is this the beginning of local government, which no party will be in charge? It will be a coalition. We're going to get used to it with lots of different parties with different agendas having a say and being kingmakers in the ultimate result.
Absolutely. And I think the rise of the civic movement, the rise of the local party, the rise where local issues were at the forefront. I think, you know, we heard from Kelly in terms of the Water Heroes in Malusiopofung, they would have wished to be a beneficiary of that, but other places there are these civic movements and these local parties that have done really, really well, and they bring a different flavour to political negotiations and political discussions because they campaigned on very localised, very specific issues. So definitely it's going to be interesting to see how the talks go about, because again, the big parties are not familiar with them. Secondly, especially the Democratic Alliance sort of discarded these small parties,
yes,
and almost kicked them out of the race before the race even started.
And wanted to make it a two-horse race.
Absolutely.
Which we now know, I mean, the one message from this election, the
it's
elite
not.
Politics has been dismissed by the electorate.
Absolutely.
The DA and the ANC are suffering tonight.
Absolutely, and I think that is the bigger message, the reconfiguration of how we saw elite politics, where you had this two-horse race and a third sort of newcomer every 5 years. That has been turned on its head in most areas. Again, still obviously, predominantly, you know, DA versus ANC. However, what you said to me this morning, we have to look at number three and four and five.
Well, if it's going to be good for service delivery or not, the jury will be out on that for the next 5 years. We will cover it. Thank you for joining us at Ballot Box tonight on Tuesday evening. We will be back with you tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. Follow all the action throughout the night on News24. Thank you for joining us. Goodbye.